This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond X Studios here. This best list is the closest I've ever come to canceling one of my videos. No, I'm serious. I had basically no desire to do this video. Even after I'd been chipping away at a script and writing down jokes and observations for months, I was inches away from scrapping it all and just not doing it this year. Honestly, I probably would have done it if Ethan hadn't reminded me that these videos are literally how I pay for my food. I just didn't feel like a best hit songs of 2021 list was really necessary, to which you're probably thinking, oh shit, was 2021 really that bad for popular music that you had nothing good to say about it? No. 2021 was actually probably the best year for pop music in the past 2 decades. You know, on average.
Wait for the signal and I'll meet you after dark.
Yeah, no, there was plenty of good music in 2021. Almost too much, to be honest. If you compare the average quality of the top 40 hits of a bunch of random years, 2021 very well might have the highest average of them all. The problem is that that's mostly a function of quantity, not quality. Even if 2021 did have the largest number of good songs to become popular, it didn't really have that many defined peaks to it. There were about 30 or 40 songs that I could call the best hits of the year, and it felt like I was just throwing darts at a board to decide the songs that made this list. For me, listening to good music this year was like surfing on a huge, beautiful wave. And trying to pick my 10 favorite songs of the year was kind of like trying to pick my 10 favorite gallons of water that made up that wave. That's just not really how I thought about it. To be honest, ever since the day I started my channel, I've been constantly trying to one-up myself with every new release. And so in a video like this, where I not only have no cameos or flamethrowers or other eye-catching gimmicks, but I also don't feel as strongly as I usually do, I kind of feel like I'm letting you guys down, and that definitely contributed to how hard this video was to make. But you know what? I think that's just something I need to get over. I know I shouldn't force spectacle into places where it doesn't need to be, and that's a quick way to both wear out its welcome and bloat my channel and scope until it becomes unsustainable. But more to the point, if the best hit songs of 2021 spoke to me on a more primal level rather than a more cerebral way that engaged my brain, there's nothing wrong with that. There's a time and a place for simpler, more straightforward content, and when that content is a straightforward look back at easily one of the strongest years of pop music I can remember, well, I'd say you definitely could do worse than that. It's time to count down. Real quick note on eligibility before we start. Traditionally, when doing these lists, I've limited myself to Billboard's year-end list of the 100 biggest songs of the year. Like I said before, literally every year has plenty of good music if you look for it, so I really wanted to limit my options to the absolute biggest hits. But also, like I've said before, the Billboard charts have a lot of weird, esoteric rules that leave a lot of blind spots, so I don't want to pull from them exclusively anymore. I was planning on also using the year-end charts of the more consumer-driven Rolling Stone Top 100, but unfortunately, they decided to discontinue that chart this past October. Fortunately, my friend Lydia Valentino recently started her own music chart, which uses an updated version of the Rolling Stone formula with a few changes and tweaks. And so as of now, in addition to Billboard, my year-end rankings will use every song that made the year-end top 100 for the V30 chart. I've linked both the chart and Lydia's channel in the description, so you can head over there if you have any questions about this. Thanks for understanding, and now, on with the show.
I'm through with standing in line, so pubs I'll never get in. It's like the bottom of the ninth and I'm never gonna win. Life hasn't turned out quite the way I want it to be.
Tell me what you want.
Slow down, pipe down, you know I'll be when I come around.
So I don't typically have many opportunities to go out of my way to listen to new music. Pretty much all my free time is spent making these videos, and so if I'm listening to music, it's almost always for work. Incidentally, that's one reason why I love doing grab bag reviews so much. It lets me take a look at a ton of music that's never gonna chart anywhere, since my patrons' musical taste is equal parts awesome and absolutely fucking terrifying. Pretty much the only time outside of grab bag reviews I really get to dive deep into non-charting music is when I'm driving in the car with my brothers, since I usually give them control of the the aux cord, and they both have very eclectic and usually very solid tastes. Those tastes are usually pretty left of the dial, mostly a bunch of experimental hip-hop and jazz fusion, but every once in a while, the stars will align perfectly, and not only will I recognize a certain name repeated over and over again from song to song, but that person will, against all odds, find an opportunity to cross over into my world. The Sunday Best Guys are no longer my biggest I knew them before they got big act, and I think that fact might just increase my net worth as a human being. When I saw Kali Uchis with an actual charting hit, while it was incredible, I was also kinda caught off guard. To be clear, my brothers aren't big Kali Uchis stans or anything. I honestly don't even think they know who she is, but she has a tendency of popping up on the feature list of the exact kinds of acts they're into, including but not limited to Vince Staples, Gorillaz, Mac Miller, Tyler the Creator, and Anderson .Paak's backup band, the Free Nationals. This woman has found her way into some good-ass stables, and she made enough of an impression on me, even as a feature in the background, that her name did ring a bell when I saw her song Telepatia becoming an instant smash hit on TikTok and then slowly gaining streaming and airplay over time until it became one of the biggest sleeper hits of 2021. However, what caught me off guard wasn't the fact that Kali Uchis had a hit. If anything, it makes perfect sense. Her brand of dreamlike, thoughtful R&B fits the pop world absolutely flawlessly right now. It makes total sense that she was able to break out of her scene. No, what caught me off guard was that I had only ever heard her sing in English. Telepatia is an incredible piece of music. It really is one of those songs that makes the room go quiet whenever it comes on. On the level of structure, it really is one of the purest musical joys of the year. You are being lifted by a cloud of gorgeous sound, a blending of production so special and expertly crafted that I have a hard time even telling the individual instruments apart. Honestly, this instrumental doesn't even sound like something human hands constructed out of an amalgamation of different instruments and effects. It sounds like someone went up to heaven, scooped up a bucket of clouds, and then poured them into an exquisite bath for Kali to bathe in, and that bath has put her in the mood to coo. So yeah, the production and vocals are among the best I've ever heard on the pop charts, and the whole lyrical conceit of being so close to someone that you can feel them telepathically no matter the distance between you could not be a better match for the ethereal tone set by the presentation. And all of this alone is easily enough to make this one of my favorite songs of the year. But what cinched it a spot in the most competitive top 10 I've ever made are two things: the language and the context behind it.
You stay on the phone just to hear me breathe.
Ever since Despacito, there's been an absolute explosion of Spanish songs into the American mainstream. They're really not that noteworthy on their own anymore. But let's face it, only a very specific type of Spanish music has been eating up most of that success. Pretty much every Spanish crossover has been some variation of reggaeton, always either upbeat party songs or douche bro pity parties. And any English has either come from a collaboration with an English-speaking artist or an awkward remix specifically aiming for crossover appeal, usually both. And Telepatia is the only hit I can think of that actually blends the two languages rather than just smashing them together.
You know I got a lot to say, all these voices in the background of my brain.
Kali Uchis is a child of immigrants. She spent her childhood back and forth between Virginia and Colombia, so she is totally in her element the entire time. Neither language feels forced. Even though Spanish and English have such distinctive sonic palettes from each other, she's able to flow like water between the two of them, turning that diversity into a strength that creates a totally unique listening experience compared to any other hit of the year. 2021 was the year the American mainstream realized that in Spanish didn't have to be a song's only quality. Yeah, we could have reggaeton, we could also have Spanish dance music, Spanish EDM, Spanish R&B, and so, so much more. The explosion of diversity within Latin music on the Hot 100 may not have been the flashiest trend of the year, but it is definitely one of the ones that has me the most excited for the future. And Telepatia is a glorious, shining beacon of all of the brilliant places that future could be headed.
Squalls and a big black ship with some cannonballs. Don't wanna join Davy Jones 20,000 leagues under the sea.
So how you gonna do it?
Okay, fair warning to all of you. This is gonna be one of those entries. You know, one of those entries where things get difficult. This is actually the only time this is going to happen this year. We are going to be talking about some heavy stuff later down the road, but we're still going to be able to talk about those later entries without things getting difficult. I mean, look, this definitely was one of my favorite songs of the year, and it undoubtedly deserves to be in this top 10, but the song itself really isn't the main thing we're going to have to talk about here, and when you see what song it is, you'll understand why. Okay, let's do this. This was a bad year for country music.
Yeah, but now I'm dodging potholes in my sunburned Silverado.
Dangerous, the double album by Morgan Wallen, was the most successful release of 2021. As I write this, exactly one full year into its run, it's still at number 3 on the album charts, just barely behind Adele and the Encanto soundtrack, and ahead of Taylor, Drake, Doja, and The Weeknd. The album spent 10 weeks at number 1 earlier this year, and while there is a good chance that this was in large part thanks to the publicity from Wallen's name trending all over the place after he was caught yelling the N-word while drunk in public, the continued success of the album has made it pretty damn clear that this wasn't a fluke. The public genuinely loved this album from the bottom of their hearts, and this is something that I find to be incredibly frustrating.
It's all my fault, yeah, I dropped the ball.
I firmly believe that bad people are capable of making good art, and I do think that Dangerous, the double album, is very good art. I mean, yeah, it's a bit bloated, but it's a mainstream double-length country album. It'd be a miracle if it wasn't bloated, and it did have enough great songs to make up for it. Purely based on the quality of its content, I do understand why this album was so huge, but very rarely in popular music have I ever seen a bargain more Faustian than this. I'm not gonna turn this entire segment into a diatribe on how a white man at the top of the country scene using a racist slur can and did cause genuine damage. Much more qualified people than me have already said all of that, but suffice it to say that it did matter, and it was an insult to the people of color in Nashville who have enough systemic obstacles working against them already without the explosive success of a white man using slurs being shoved in their faces. Trust me, I'm well aware that the Morgan Wallen situation is only the tip of the systemic racism iceberg within Nashville, and even Nashville is just the tip of the systemic racism iceberg within the entertainment industry in the United States on whole, but at the end of the day, that's not what this video is about. This is a video where some rando online talks about some trendy Spotify jams that made his ears happy. My job is to look at the very most popular songs in America, regardless of what they are, and to judge which ones I find to be the most well-made, regardless of the people behind them. Therefore, for the sake of this video, I'm going to judge Morgan Wallen not as a person, but as an artist, and he is a very good artist. The appeal of Sand in My Boots is pretty straightforward. I used to think Wallen's voice was pretty over-the-top and cartoon. There are plenty of songs where it's too much and he just winds up sounding ridiculous, like on that new song he just put out with Lil Durk.
There's two things that you're gonna find out.
Yeah, that's a disaster for another day. Stay tuned for that one. When used wrong, Morgan Wallen's voice can be catastrophic, but at the same time, his distinctiveness really does play to his advantage when it's used right. He's a very naturally warm and charming presence when he's toned down, and so give him a classic country song packed with details and flowing lyricism about a girl who steals his heart after a wild night on the town, and he absolutely kills it.
She said, "Don't care, boys drink whiskey." So we drank bottom shelf.
The verses paint such a vivid picture of who this girl was and the real chemistry they found together immediately in such a short time together. You really do want to see them together, but then
I said, "Meet me in the morning." And she told me I was crazy, yeah, but I still thought that maybe she'd show up.
Absolutely heartbreaking.
Oh, but now I'm dodging potholes in my sunburned Silverado.
The chorus throughout the song sounded fantastic and did give you an idea of where things were gonna end, but that final repetition is absolutely devastating. The massive weight of the incredible life they could have had together crushes down on you as Wallen makes you really feel the crushing loneliness of the sun-baked drive away from her, ending with that final stake directly through your heart.
Something about the way she kissed me tells me she loves Eastern Tennessee. Yeah, but all I brought back with me was some sand in my boots.
Morgan Wallen is a new brand of country singer who does a lot of things different from both the traditionalist and his contemporaries, but he has managed to find the raw soul of country music, the pure, unfiltered musical storytelling that has the power to burrow its way into your soul. One way or another, I think it's absolutely indisputable that moving forward, we're all going to be watching keenly to see what Morgan Wallen does next.
I'm gonna trade this life for fortune and fame. I'd even grow my beard and change my name.
Well, that was fucking exhausting. Good God, I'm glad to have that off my chest, though. I'm holding onto that one for a long time. Jeez, though, can we talk about something a little bit more lighthearted than the whole Morgan Wallen situation now? I don't know, something a little bit more fun and pleasant to discuss, like, you know, I don't know, getting locked up in federal prison?
I sentenced you to 5 years in Montero State Prison.
Oh, thank God.
I told you long ago, on the road, I got what they waiting for.
Lil Nas X was one of my favorite things about being alive in 2021. Actually, come to think of it, Lil Nas X was one of my favorite things about being alive in 2019, too. Lil Nas X is one of my favorite things about being alive.
And this one is for the champions. And lost since I began.
No, for real, I can't properly explain just how much I love this. I grew up in the age of Lady Gaga. The era of the Bad Romance video and the meat dress did and forever will influence my perception of what a pop star should be. A provocateur that gets people talking by fisting their oddness into the cynical asshole of pop culture and embodying the phrase too much in the most glorious manner imaginable. Granted, Lil Nas X did start his internet life as a stand of another artist who loved to do way too much in all the best ways, but the key difference there is that the whole too much aesthetic bled into Nicki's music as well. You have to be a very specific type of person to enjoy Anaconda or Stupid Ho, whereas Telephone and Alejandro definitely had their own flavor but still fit in quite well into the scene around them despite their outlandish presentation. Now, to be clear, there is absolutely nothing wrong with having your music be as over the top as your image. I actually am one of the people who love the Anacondas and Money Machines of the world, but it's typically only when an artist manages to find that perfect balance between flashy presentation and musical restraint that they're able to capture the eye of the national conversation. And I don't think it's a coincidence that Lil Nas X is the first new artist in a long time to get your average passerby on the street talking, even if he's outside of their typical musical bubble. He's managed to take pop rap and update it for modern sensibilities, injecting enough of his own individualism and personal aesthetic to make it wildly entertaining, but not so much as to alienate people, not overkill. After an entire year of wondering whether the Old Town Road Kid was gonna be a fluke, seeing him dominate the entire country, first by taking a stripper pole to hell to give Satan a lap dance, and then by uploading a naked prison shower dance which he constantly teased the uncensored version of, was everything I could have hoped for and more. Much like the last two songs, and indeed most of the songs on this list, the appeal to Industry Baby as a song is pretty straightforward. A few months ago, I said that if anyone had the right to remake We Are the Champions for Gen Z, it's Lil Nas X. And yeah, that's basically what this is. It's not a replacement for We Are the Champions, since that's a timeless anthem, and this song is just about as 2021 as you could possibly get, but very rarely has any song ever projected such a pure aura of victory, and it works because Lil Nas X has earned every last bit of it. The man got the longest running number one hit of all time with a complete and total gimmick, took a year off, and then came back and became the biggest pop star in the world purely on his own terms. He's earned the right to parade his victory through the streets, flanked by an entourage of pure hype. And when you get Take a Day Trip and Kanye West as your producers and Kick the Brass into overdrive, it reaches a point of critical mass where the pure energy of it all threatens to overwhelm you. There's a reason this instantly became the biggest song in the world despite the weird, clunky title. And honestly, Jack Harlow's bit is the cherry on top of all of this.
I don't clear up rumors. Hey, where's y'all sense of humor? Hey, I'm done making jokes because they got old like baby boomers.
His entire vibe is that of a cool, laid-back, funny dude who doesn't have false modesty but isn't in the business of trying too hard either. And I think he's the element that diffuses the song from being too much. He's not too cool to try, but he knows the frequency he vibes at and never really leaves it. He's just a normal, humble dude who just so happens to be winning. And the different flavor he adds is really what elevates this to the next level for me. Even though both men on this song talk about no one but themselves, they want to share their victory and sweep you up in their hype, and they succeed with flying colors. There are very few human beings on Earth who should feel better about their prospects moving into the new year than these two, and I can't wait to ride their tailwind to wherever they decide to take us next.
I'm the hero. this weaving.
We all just wanna be big rock stars, living hilltop houses, driving 15 cars. The girls come easy and the drugs come cheap. We all stay skinny cause we just won't eat.
So to you other kids all across the land, there's no need to argue, parents just don't understand.
You know, I'm not gonna lie, I really did not think that this is where we were heading with this.
Meet me at a spot. Cut a vibe. Baby, are you coming for the ride?
The ride, the ride.
I just wanna look into your eyes.
I've seen a good number of people absolutely refuse to buy into any of the hype surrounding Willow Smith's inexplicable return as one of the hottest musical artists of 2021. I have to admit, I saw everyone absolutely losing their mind over Transparent Soul all throughout the year, holding Willow up as the inspiring, triumphant new star of the burgeoning pop-punk revival, and yeah, I can understand why that much hype given to the child of the single biggest showbiz couple on the planet is cause for skepticism. But then again, the song does absolutely deserve it, so yeah, no harm, no foul.
Something's got a hold of me, feel it taking over me.
Regardless of how it got big, the fact is that Meet Me at Our Spot by The Anxiety, which is the name of the alt-rock duo composed of Willow and her boyfriend Tyler Cole, was easily one of TikTok's greatest finds of the year. 2021 felt like the year where millennials fully completed the passing of the pop music torch over to Gen Z. Not only were the biggest, most exciting new names of the year all young kids, but they didn't hide their age, nor any of the baggage that came with it. Turns out when you tell an entire generation that their teens and 20s are going to be the best years of their lives, and then those years end up dominated by economic catastrophe, explosive racial tensions, a psychopath and a useless wastoid running the country, and a pandemic killing a 9/11's worth of Americans every single day, they're going to get a little stressed out. And no song did a better job than this one at capturing those days where the world just doesn't seem worth waking up for.
I slept through the day, fuck, I'm not getting younger.
But at the same time, it's not a defeatist song either. I mean, yeah, obviously a song about getting pissed off at yourself for sleeping through the day is gonna strike a chord, but at the same time, the song is primarily a love letter to the small things they're able to do that make the passing days more bearable, from acute drunk texts to the hypnotic blurry lights as you speed down a nighttime highway to finding your own spot away from all the horror where you can just vibe out with the person you love.
I just got a drunk text, meet me at a spot.
Meet Me at Our Spot is the kind of song that you can show anyone who doesn't get kids these days with their Tic Tacs and their Spider-Verse and their NFLs, and they'll be able to understand that the same anxiety that's always existed in teenagers is still around, amplified by a sense of isolation within a world that purports to be more connected than ever, and that we're all just trying to cope with in whatever way we can. It also certainly doesn't hurt that Willow is a damn good singer, a bit strained in places, but certainly very expressive, while Tyler Cole is honestly a great singer who kind of steals the show. It feels kind of wrong to judge them as singers individually, though, because the blending of their two voices is not only what sounds the best, but also best represents why this song is so special.
Meet me at a spot, got something I wanna show you. Meet me at a spot.
Meet Me at Our Spot managed to capture the collective pain of an entire generation, while also showing that the pain isn't gonna keep us down, and that optimism is always worth holding on to, even when we're at our lowest. Very few songs touched me like this one did in 2021. And if you still think Willow Smith is a pampered, overrated debutante just leeching off of daddy's money, well, let's just say I think I know how she would respond to that.
This must be the lie.
The latest dictionary and today's who's who. We'll get you anything with that evil smile.
Everybody's got a rum dealer on speed dial.
So here's a question. Have we considered that the song that made Olivia Rodrigo a household name overnight is actually the best song she's put out so far?
And I know.
Despite all the hype it got upon its release, it feels like Driver's License has been kinda swallowed up by everything else Olivia Rodrigo did in 2021, and that's really astonishing when you think about it. Some random kid nobody outside of the Disney Channel audience had ever heard of got the fourth most streams in one day of any song in Spotify history, only behind Adele and a couple of Christmas songs, and by the end of the year, that was just a minor footnote in her list of accomplishments. Sour really was a grand tour de force of all the ways that teenagers turned popular music on its head in 2021. It showed that Olivia was an incredible, multifaceted force to be reckoned with, and so I suppose it makes sense that Driver's License kinda got dismissed as yesterday's fad as soon as the album dropped, because honestly, it's kinda basic. Songs like Good For You, Deja Vu, and Brutal simply would not have been hits if they had been released at pretty much any point in the past 5 years other than this one, whereas Driver's License absolutely would have. This song doesn't break any molds, it does what's been proven to work and colors within the lines, but holy fucking damn does it know how to color.
Yeah, today I drove through the suburbs and pictured I was driving home to you.
I've tried to make an active effort in the past few years to phrase things in my own way and not quote other critics directly, but when Todd in the Shadow said that Olivia is a good singer, but more importantly, she's a good actress, he hit the nail on the head. I was having trouble figuring out exactly what about Driver's License I found to be so utterly captivating, and that's what it is. Olivia clearly took this breakup incredibly hard. The entire album was all about capturing the pieces of her broken heart from different angles, but Driver's License doesn't focus on her anger or her spite or her regret. It's pure, uncut, heart-rending sadness, and she knows how to capture all of the nuance of that with her voice, from the subtle inflections when she switches from addressing the guy to addressing herself.
Yet today I drove through the suburbs, 'cause how could I ever love someone else?
To the way she can barely even bring herself to say the words blonde girl.
And you're probably with that blonde girl who always made me doubt.
To how absolutely and utterly devastated she sounds when she realizes that the boy she loved is able to move on without her.
And I just can't imagine how you could be so okay, now that I'm gone.
Not only is this a grippingly authentic performance, but it's so expertly delivered that every listen reveals a new layer of pain you missed the first time. It really is a song that rewards repeated listens. I know I praised Todd for his insight a second ago, but one thing that he and a bunch of other people said that bothered me about this one was that the immaturity of its songwriting was a bad thing.
You said forever, now I drive alone past your street.
Yes, it shouldn't be a surprise to any adult listener that a teenage boy who promised to love her forever really didn't have the conviction to back those words up. And yes, Olivia was naive for thinking that he really meant it, but if you ask me, that's a feature, not a flaw. If your heart gets broken, it doesn't matter how easy it was to see coming in hindsight. In that moment, it doesn't make the hurt any less real. And if you're a skilled enough artist to be able to capture the full breadth of your own personal pain, then I have nothing but respect for that. The same intense teenage immaturity that caused me to get sick of Good For You in record time is the reason why Driver's License has aged like a fine wine. We broke up and I'm feeling catty and jealous is a sentiment that can get really irritating turned up to 10 if I'm not in the mood for it. But we broke up, my heart has been shattered for the first time, and everything around me is turning into a vortex of despair because it all holds memories of you? That's a concept where turning it up to 10 is, like, the objectively correct decision. I could point out more reasons why I find this to be an exceptionally well-made breakup song, like the interesting main premise of getting your driver's license too late to be able to drive to the house of someone you loved, or the cool production touches that blend the engine noises of her car into the beat, or the foresight to actually move the song along at a decent tempo to keep it from getting too mopey, or the most iconic bridge in 21st century pop culture so far, don't at me.
Red lights, stop signs, I still see your face.
Oh, and on the subject, that F-bomb is completely earned. The bridge really needed something to cap it off and feel like the final explosion, and that is what does it.
'Cause I still fucking love you, babe.
Probably been a while since you've listened to Driver's License, but trust me, give it another look. You're in for an absolute powerhouse of a heartbreak ballad that's permanently etched itself into the bedrock of Gen Z pop culture. Keep running shit, Olivia. The world is yours now.
You said forever, now I drive alone past your street.
And with that, we've nearly reached the end of part one of this video. We still have the first half of the honorable mentions to talk about today before we wrap up, but before we do that, I'd like to remind you all to leave this video a like, subscribe, and hit the bell for notifications of every new upload, and leave a comment with your thoughts on the video, the pop music of 2021, or literally anything else you want to talk about. The more engagement I get, the more likely Algorithm Chan is to finally notice me. And I'm still really bummed that Dua Lipa hasn't answered any of my calls since the carousel incident, so leave as many comments as you can to help me bounce back. And of course I'm gonna need money for the date, so please consider supporting me on Patreon. A pledge of just $1 per main series video will get your name in the end credits of every video I make. $2 per video will let you suggest and vote for any songs in the world you want me to talk about in Grab Bag Reviews. $5 per video will grant you access to an awesome community of people on my official Discord server. $10 per video will get you a whole bunch of stuff, including early access to my videos, a personalized icon in the end credits, and the ability to pick the charting songs that get shoutouts in my seasonal top 20 rankings. And for $20 per video, on top of everything else, you get to personally pick any song for me to do a guaranteed review on in each new episode of Grab Bag Reviews. On top of this, all of my patrons of every level have an equal chance to be selected to give a patron review in every video I make. So without further ado, let's see what today's lucky patrons have to say about their favorite hit songs of 2021. From Tangrowth Hat regarding Happier Than Ever by Billie Eilish.
Very few things this year annoyed me as much as the number of Happier Than Ever remixes on YouTube that just cut the first half out. If you want that, listen to Willow or Machine Gun Kelly or Paramore or even Olivia. But Billie adds his nuance, which is way more rare and valuable to that sound. This distracts from getting an actual radio push with some sort of abbreviated version. Or radios could stop being cowardly 5-minute songs. That would be nice too.
From Cadius regarding Thought Shit by Megan Thee Stallion. This is a pretty fun song to listen to, especially on the radio. I was scanning through radio stations one night and I heard Thought Shit playing. I knew I had to listen to what the radio station did with the swear words. They removed most of the swears except the word thought. Megan just says the word thought twice instead of saying thought shit. Even better, the word ass is sloppily edited out, so it still sounds like the word ass, but with a weird sound effect on it. Listening to Thought Shit on the radio was a life-changing experience that will never happen again, since there's no way Radio Gods Die Hard are gonna play that song ever again. It was fun while it lasted. From Barry regarding Thumbs by Lucy Dacus.
Thumbs is a masterpiece of minimalism. Simple tune, lyrics blunt and pulled back, a droning ambient instrumental that when combined hit you like a freight train of emotions. If you have a scumbag dad or a friend with a shitty family life, this song feels like getting run over by an SUV in like the absolute best way, perfectly capturing the absolute rage you can feel against those who hurt the people you love.
From Rid regarding Our Song by Anne-Marie and Niall Horan.
Our Song is Anne-Marie's best single as lead artist, and I doubt she'll ever top it. It's a wholesome love song about two exes remembering their relationship fondly after hearing their song on the radio, possibly at the same time. The lyrics work masterfully in tandem with the instrumental, plus Anne-Marie and Niall singing the same lyrics in the verses, then singing the hook together, makes them come off as kindred spirits in a sense. It's a wonderful song.
And last but not least, from that guy that always threatened Sean with Latvian choral music for Grab Bag Reviews regarding ZDE Buoni by Måneskin. This year was really great for the two most recent Eurovision winners, Duncan Lawrence and, of course, Måneskin, who had more success with their follow-up Beggin' and I Wanna Be Your Slave. As an avid Eurovision fan, I'll say that I don't necessarily love any of Måneskin's work, but I am really pleased that something like this won. Eurovision needed a lot of shaking up, and this year's contest showed us that we are ready to move away from all pleasing but not necessarily groundbreaking pop sounds, Arcade for example, to something much more daring and authentic. Thank you all for your continued support. I've got some huge plans for this channel going into 2021, and I could use all the financial support I can get. I truly can't thank all of you enough for continuing to support me and let me run this channel full time. Y'all are the reason that everything I do is possible. And now let's wrap up the video by taking a look at the first half of the honorable mentions.
I wanna be a rock star.
May have gleaned from watching my worst list, there were very few big country hits this year that I thought were really worth much of anything, so I ended up looking a bit further down the charts for my Nashville fix, with Somebody Like That by Tennille Arts being probably my favorite smaller country hit of the year. Not only is it genuinely groundbreaking as by far the biggest country song ever written and produced entirely by women, but it's just a very sweet, straightforward, well-made song, the kind where you understand it completely after the first listen, but that doesn't stop you from wanting to return to it over and over again.
But he's the poster child for happy years,
as Happy does.
I have no idea why Kenny Chesney is still a thing in 2021, but honestly, this was the first time in a long time that I was happy to see his name. I feel like the phrase happy is as Happy does is something we're all really gonna need to hang on to as we barrel further into the screaming 20s, and I'm glad that now the phrase has its own theme song.
Yeah, I love me some California, but it sure ain't Tennessee.
I gotta say, it was really nice to hear one of those city folks just don't understand us country boys songs that actually admits that there are in fact some cool upsides to living a fast-paced city life, even if the small town is always going to be where your heart is. I'm starting to realize that Thomas Rhett is actually pretty good when he's not being the worst thing ever.
To find someone great, but don't find no one better.
I'm probably never going to fully come around on Traitor. I've just accepted that by this point. But that doesn't mean Olivia Rodrigo is incapable of making slow, sad songs. Happier was one of my favorite pieces on the album, where she struggles with wishing her ex well while still holding on to the selfish wish that nobody he finds will ever be better than her, and it just comes together really well.
Well, I hope I was your favorite crush.
And same idea with this one. Yeah, don't get it twisted. Just because I'm sick of Good For You doesn't mean I don't think Olivia Rodrigo is one of the most talented and game-changing artists around right now.
I'd be by the phone, standing like morning into dawn.
This dude genuinely made a song about how loving and accepting Stan Twitter is, and it made me tear up because it was so moving. What the actual fuck is he on, and where can I get some?
Take my breath away and make it last forever.
Okay, yeah, I've come around 100% on this one. All it took was one late night drive down a highway with this song blaring at maximum volume to realize that I don't care how many times he recycles the same tired 80s cliches over and over, The Weeknd is a treasure, and I'll never get so sick of him that he's not worth eventually coming back to. Same with this one. It may have taken the remix for me to realize how great this song was, but even after a year, its stock is still rising, and I'm honestly debating whether I should have put it on the list proper.
As soon as you give them your soul, you blow up and they say you're selling your soul, okay?
You know, Certified Lover Boy may have been a bloated, overlong waste, but I don't think we should let that wipe the taste of the genuinely very good Scary Hours 2 out of our mouths. Late 2000s Timba T.I. electro hip-hop production wasn't something I was aware I was nostalgic for, by the way.
I need me some Jesus in my life, hey.
And after holding out for years, this was the song that finally made me ready to forgive these two for Yes Indeed. Drake and Lil Baby are like hip-hop loot boxes. They're really bad for the landscape on whole, and a lot of the time they'll give you nothing but disappointing crap, but damn it, all you need is that one spectacular pull, and you've got yourself a fresh hit of dopamine and a craving for more.
On the road to riches, I can never lay around, so don't make a sound unless you make it loud.
I don't know a single person in real life who saw Shang-Chi and The Legend of Ten Rings in theaters or otherwise, but apparently someone had the absolutely insane idea to combine DJ Snake with Rick Ross for the soundtrack, and it somehow turned into one of the hardest bangers of the year. Also, a big shout out to newcomer Rich Brian, an Indonesian rapper who had some viral success in 2016 and really seems to be getting an industry push right now. I wouldn't be surprised if we saw more of him moving forward.
Whoa, I'm a big bag hunter with the bow. She got a big bed, number drop low.
Same with his co-star on this song, Bibi No Money, who did get some attention from La 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 a few years back, but in my opinion, is still poised for a really big mainstream breakthrough pretty soon. Honestly, I'm surprised this wasn't it. I heard it on the radio a good few times, and it's a big, fun, goofy rap song that I'm surprised TikTok didn't absolutely eat up. There's a whole interconnected stable of dorky quasi-comedy rappers, you know, Bibi No Money, Young Gravy, DJ Young Vamp, and I'm just waiting for the day that they take over the world, because trust me, it's coming.
Cause I remember every time.
I'm so glad Giveon had another hit this year besides Peaches. I've looked into this guy a bit since this song dropped, and I think he has the potential to absolutely dominate the 2020s R&B scene, even if I have a sneaking suspicion that this is gonna be his only hit. Please prove me wrong, America.
BMW, new deposit, I picked up another bag, like fuck it, I'ma count while I'm in it.
Man, I severely underestimated just how much people care about Polo G. I legit thought he was gonna just wind up as another XXL freshman burnout, and here he is now as the biggest rapper of 2021. I mean, granted, he is apparently really good, so it's not like I can say he doesn't deserve it.
He's been freaking me out.
I saw this one on a surprising number of worst lists this year, and I won't act like I don't see it. There are definitely some clunky parts in there, and this song did single-handedly prove that something could become overplayed solely through TikTok before then becoming the first song ever to become overplayed in both TikTok and on the radio. But you know what? They still managed to jam in hooks for days and a nice, languid vibe that has a ton of mass appeal. It's nothing nothing special, and I have a feeling that I'm going to be extremely sick of it by the time 2022 is over, but you know what? Regardless of how disposable it may be, heat waves brought me a ton of joy throughout 2021. And at the end of the day, isn't that what pop music is for? I'm Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamond X Studios, and thank you guys so much for being patient and waiting for me to get this one out. I promise I'll get part two out as soon as I can. See you then.
I just wanna slide. Parties in the sky like it's 2055. She said, boy, you nice. Boy, you nice. Heart cold like some water and some ice.